physiology.
So hello there, class, again, and welcome again to this next class where today we are going to discuss about active transport. So in the previous classes, remember we discussed about the physiological process we mentioned about active transport, osmosis and diffusion, and now today we are going to discuss in depth concerning the active transport. And let's define what is active transport. So you say this, that active transport is the movement of substances across the membrane against the concentration gradient. So the particles must move against the concentration gradient. If they must be moving from low to high, therefore active transport moves them from high to low. If they must be moving from high to low, active transport will move them from low to high. So for active transport to take place, there must be energy and carriers. So energy must be involved, and then carriers must also be involved. So sugars, amino acids, and ions are taken up by active transport inside the living organisms. That one you must always remember. So let's look at the factors affecting active transport. So the first one, we have temperature. So active transport works best in optimum temperature. It must not be too high or too low. So let's look at glucose concentration, whereby the more the glucose concentration is, therefore active transport is going to work faster. So if we have low amount of glucose concentration, active transport will be low in performance. So the next one, let's look at oxygen concentration. So what about oxygen concentration? So oxygen must be present for respiration to take place for the production of energy. And with this energy, active transport is going to work in a desired way. So the next one, let's look at pH level. So the pH must be optimum. It must not be too much basic or too much acidic. So the pH must be optimum. So finally, let's look at enzyme inhibitors, whereby the more the enzyme inhibitors, the more energy will be produced at a very low rate, and therefore this will affect active transport. So the enzyme inhibitors shouldn't be there for active transport to function in an optimum or in a good way. So the more the enzyme inhibitors, the low the rate of active transport. So let's look at the roles of active transport finally in animals and in plants. Let's begin with plants. So the active transport in plants, what are the roles? So first of all, we have absorption of some minerals in the roots. Then lastly, we have movement of photosynthetic products from the leaves to the phloem of the plant. So let's look at the roles of active transport in animals, and we finish by this. So we say that we have absorption of digested food from the ileum to the blood through active transport. Then the next one, we have reabsorption of nutrients. Example, you might give examples like we have glucose and we have amino acids from the kidney to the bloodstream. Then again, we have excretion of waste products from the cell is through active transport. Then we have functioning of the sodium ion pumps mechanism in the nerve cell, whereby we are going to look at this in the reception, response, and coordination topic. Then we have, lastly, we have the accumulation of substances in the body to offset the osmotic imbalance in mainly the arid and the saline area organisms. Because in these organisms, we have too much salinity, which might dehydrate the organism, or we might have too much heat, which might also dehydrate this organism. So active transport plays a major role in trying to maintain the osmotic balance in the organism. So let's look at active transport on this side, then passive transport on the other side. So on this active transport side, the first difference will say that it occurs against the concentration gradient. So what about the passive transport? It occurs along the concentration gradient. So the next difference is that the active transport is affected by oxygen concentration. So the more the oxygen concentration, the more the energy production, the more the respiration, therefore the more the rate of active transport. But on the passive side, it is not affected by oxygen concentration. That is diffusion and osmosis. It's not affected by oxygen concentration. So let's look at this other side for active transport again, where we see that energy is required on this side, while on the side of osmosis or diffusion, that is passive transport, energy is not required. So the other difference is that the active transport side, it transports ions, proteins, and complex sugars, while in osmosis, we transport glucose, water, oxygen, and gas. So lastly, we are going to look at the difference in the active transport side, and we'll see that it disrupts equilibrium established by diffusion. So it must disrupt. If the equilibrium by diffusion says that molecules should move from high to low, active transport will always disrupt that and move molecules from low to high. Let's look at the passive side. So in the passive side, no diffusion or osmosis occur after equilibrium has been established. So if the equilibrium has been established, no process will occur or no diffusion or osmosis will occur in the passive side. Because you remember diffusion, we say that molecules are moving from high to low, and in the diffusion side, we say that in the osmosis side rather, we say that molecules move from low to high, and that is from hypotonic to hypertonic solutions. So in the active transport, there is no consideration where the molecule should move from hyper to hypo or hypo to hyper. No, it's not there. And that's why in this last point, we say that in the passive side, no diffusion or osmosis occur after the equilibrium has been established. So that is that, and let's meet on the next class as we proceed in biology discussion. Biology.